right, so as usual, just want to give you a brief description of what I've put on Georgia View for you as regards this particular text. The first link is to a YouTube video of a light opera by the American composer Leonard Bernstein that's based on Candide. If you're having trouble just sort of following the plot, it's probably not a bad idea to sort of, you know, sit and watch and listen to this. Because it'll just sort of take you through in a fairly simple manner. It's not short, it's about 2 hours long. It's from the 1980s, must be from the 1980s because Bernstein's conducting it, so he wasn't dead yet. It's at the Barbican Theatre in London. Second link is to the website of the Voltaire Society of America, which I believe is still active, though I don't think this website has been updated in rather a long time. 1999. 2005. All right, that's better than I thought. There are a couple of resources on Voltaire and on Candide that this links to that you can check out if you feel so inclined. We've also got a brief video featuring, this is Professor Philip Picarino. He teaches philosophy at Queensborough Community College in New York, and he's discussing the central issue in this novel, which is the problem of evil. Basically, if God is all good and all powerful, why does evil exist in the world? All right, same problem Voltaire is trying to solve. We also have a brief essay on Leibniz's solution to the problem of evil, directly relevant to Voltaire and to Candide for reasons we'll get to over the course of the period. Let me just suggest to you before we start that Leibniz's solution to the problem of evil will probably sound to you like it's completely batshit insane. It did to Voltaire. And there's also an episode of the In Our Time podcast that is devoted specifically to Candide. So give that a listen if you have the time and the inclination. All right, so how'd this go for you?
It was interesting.
Okay, interesting, as always, is a loaded term. What was interesting about it?
All the different dynamics and stories from like place to place.
Okay, yeah, on the one hand, we don't have a single sort of continuous narrative. It's a choppy sort of narrative, right? It's what we call episodic structure. Right, what this means is that it's divided up into a series of discrete scenes or episodes. Most of which are really short, right? The chapters in this are really, really brief. Most of them are only about a page and a half long. And what links the episodes together are mostly the fact that they share the same characters, right? That these are happening to the same people. Now, there is a continuous narrative line that runs through this. It's not pure episodic, right? What is it that Candide wants or is trying to do throughout pretty much the entire course of what you read? Pardon?
Oh, I say he's trying to make everybody happy.
Is he trying to make everybody happy?
He's trying to believe that everything's for the best.
Yeah, on the one hand, yeah, he is animated by this idea that we live in the best of all possible worlds, and everything thus is organized for the best and for our benefit. And what more concrete goal does he have in mind?
He's trying to marry whatever.
Yes, he is trying to get back to Miss Cunegonda so that they can marry, right? Yes, he wants very much to marry Miss Cunegonde, who is the best of all barons' daughters in the best of all possible worlds, right? So that's the ultimate goal here. Anything else that, you know, really struck you or confused you about this? Bless you.
Just the idea and how open they were to it, that everything is linked together and it just happens, like, Pongloos, so he was like, well, I have syphilis, it happens. if it weren't for Columbus, it would go all out.
Yeah, well, let's actually go to that in a minute here, right?
About chocolate too.
Yeah, exactly. You have a page number on that?
359,
yeah, thank you. 360. Okay, yes. If we look on page 360 here, right, Pangloss replied as follows. My dear Candide, you knew Paquette, that pretty maidservant to our august baroness. In her arms I tasted the delights of paradise, which directly caused these torments of hell from which I am now suffering. She was infected with the disease and has perhaps died of it. Paquette received this present from an erudite Franciscan, who took the pains to trace it back to its source. For he had it from an elderly countess, who picked it up from a captain of cavalry, who acquired it from a marquise, who caught it from a page, who had received it from a Jesuit, who during his novitiate got it directly from one of the companions of Christopher Columbus. As for me, I shall not give it to anyone, for I am a dying man. So he gives us here the complete genealogy of his syphilis, right? Traceable directly back to Christopher Columbus's voyage to the New World. And this is actually true. Syphilis was a New World disease. It was unknown in Europe prior to Columbus's voyages. And yes, his sailors brought it back with them. Oh, Pangloss, cried Candide, that's a very strange genealogy. Isn't the devil at the root of the whole thing? Not at all, replied that great man. It's an indispensable part of the best of worlds, a necessary ingredient. If Columbus had not caught, on an American island, this sickness which attacks the source of generation, and sometimes prevents generation entirely, which thus strikes at and defeats the greatest end of nature herself, we should have neither chocolate nor cochineal. So, in exchange for a disease which prevents people from reproducing, we get chocolate and blue dye. Hey, right? Yeah. That's a fair trade, right? That's basically what Pangloss is arguing, right? We would not have these stupid little luxury items if not for syphilis. It's a necessary ingredient here. Now, the name Pangloss is Greek, and it literally translates to all tongue. So we could translate this probably a little bit more idiomatically to all talk, right? What is the essence of Pangloss's philosophy? That everything happens for a reason. And is it just that everything happens for a reason? Yeah, everything happens for the best possible reason, right? Because we live in the best of all possible worlds. Now, this particular phrase, the best of all possible worlds, is actually really important. Voltaire didn't just make this up out of whole cloth. He is quoting or paraphrasing from the work of a German philosopher of the 17th century, a guy by the name of Gottfried Wilhelm von Leibniz. You know, I wish it was convenient to just pull down the screen and show you a picture, because if you want to talk about the 17th and 18th centuries being the golden era of wigs, this was a fabulously bewigged gentleman. But in order to explain Leibniz's philosophy, it might help us to think back to the beginning of the term when we talked about René Descartes and Descartes' theory of mind and body. What did Descartes believe about the mind and the body? Does anyone recall? Which one can exist without the other? Yeah, mind doesn't need body. Therefore, mind is sort of purely mental or spiritual substance, right? The mind is immaterial. Right? Immaterial in that it doesn't have a physical material existence, not immaterial as in unimportant. So the mind is immaterial, and the body is purely material. Now, Descartes believed he was solving one of the great problems of philosophy, right? What's the relationship between the mind and the body? Ah, there we go. Mind is immaterial, body is material. Separate entities. There we go. Solved. He did not realize or anticipate that he was actually creating new problems, right? The new problem that he created was this. If the mind has no material existence, how is it that it acts upon material bodies? How is it that an immaterial substance acts upon the physical world? And Leibniz's answer to this was that it doesn't. In fact, every unit in existence, every object in existence, is what Leibniz called a monad. And monads are essentially pre-programmed by the Creator to interact with each other in specific ways. So the idea that we have free will or that our mind actually does anything, Leibniz argues, is an illusion. Right, this is an example of what would be called a determinist philosophy. Does anybody know what determinism is, what determinist means?
There has to be an answer.
Not quite. Maybe if I give you its opposite, it'll help. It's usually opposed to the idea of free will.
So there absolutely must be one answer.
There absolutely must be one answer, yeah, and everything happens because it's supposed to happen, right? It's similar to what we would call fatalism, although fatalism we tend to associate more with negativity, right? With well, nothing I do matters, so what good is it anyway, right? But yeah, determinism suggests that essentially everything that is going to happen is something that is supposed to happen. That we don't actually have free will to affect our world or our environment. Now, Leibniz combines this with an attempt to solve the problem of evil in the world, right? Which we mentioned a moment ago, right? Essentially, if God is all good and all powerful, if God is both all good and all powerful, why does he allow evil to exist in the world? Right? Why did he create a world in which evil exists? So attempts to solve this problem are called theodicies. T-H-E-O-D-I-C-Y. Now Leibniz solves this problem by saying, well, God created for us the best of all possible worlds, right? The world is flawed because it is not possible to create a better world than this one. So everything that happens in this world happens for the best. It happens for the best possible reasons, even if we can't always see what those reasons are. Now, to Voltaire, this sounds like a great big crock of horseshit. Right, this is silly to him. The best of all possible worlds? come on. Right. Why say that everything is great? Why say that everything is for the best when the evidence of your senses tends to tell you otherwise? Now, we see a lot of Leibnizian references strewn through this text, right? Not just best of all possible worlds, but you'll see references to harmony as well. Now, this refers to Leibniz's idea of pre-established harmony. Which comes from his theory of monads, right? That all of the monads in the world are programmed to behave towards each other in a manner that maintains sort of divine celestial harmony. Right, that keeps the world in balance in some way. You will also see sufficient reason an awful lot in this text. This is another Leibnizian idea. Leibniz coined the phrase principle of sufficient reason. What this means is that every phenomenon is the effect of some specific cause, and the cause of any particular effect, the cause that is enough to set off any particular effects, is its sufficient reason. So one of these chains of cause and effect reasoning that we see in the text is the one we just pointed to, right, where Candide discovers Pangloss dying of syphilis in Amsterdam, right? Where else do we see these chains? Is this the only place we see Pangloss doing this? Point me to another example. We see this kind of chain of reasoning.
On top of page 356.
Okay, yeah, can you read that for us, please, James?
Pangloss gave instruction in the
metaphysico-theologico-cosmolunigology. So he's combining metaphysics with theology, with cosmology, with insanity.
To prove admirably that there cannot possibly be an effect without a cause, and that in this best of possible worlds, the Baron's castle is the best of all castles, and his wife the best of all possible baronesses.
Keep going.
It is clear, said he, that things cannot be otherwise than they are, for since everything is made to serve an end, everything necessarily serves the best end. Observe, noses were made to support spectacles, hence we have spectacles. Legs, as anyone can plainly see, were made to be breeched, and so we have breeches. Stones were made to be shaped and to build castles with. Thus, my lord has a fine castle. For the great baron in the province should have the finest house, and since pigs were made to be eaten, we eat pork all year round. Consequently, those who say everything is well are uttering mere stupidities. They should say everything is for the best.
Thank you. Okay, so what do we get out of this particular chain of reason? Why do we get this kind of demonstration of Pangloss's thought? What does it show us?
It shows us that he's kind of simple-minded.
Okay.
Goes with the belief that everything is linked together, mm-hmm. and that's what happens, so let's just not question it and just keep moving.
Yeah, I mean, how does he relate cause to effect here?
Because we do it, it's right.
Pardon?
Because it happens, it's right.
Yeah, anything that happens, is right.
And that's
right?
The evidence you try to like show. Like you were saying, with the, because they're meat eat pig all year, it's okay, basically, to do it.
Mm-hmm.
What is it? For the greatest bear in these provinces should have the finest hide. And since pigs were made to be eaten, we eat pork all year round. So because they eat all year round, he's trying to justify.
Mm-hmm.
That's why they're made.
So because pigs exist, right, they must have some purpose, right? Now, he's read a purpose onto pigs that benefits him, right? You know, a vegetarian might disagree with the idea that pigs were made to be eaten. But yeah, so he's read a purpose onto objects that benefits him, right? This explanation, all of his explanations essentially keep him comfortable and out of trouble, right? When Jacques the Anabaptist, one of the few genuinely admirable characters in the whole novel, falls into the Bay of Lisbon, why does Pangloss stop Candide from saving him?
He says it's for the best.
The bay was designed for the Anabaptist to drown in, right? That's the purpose of this bay. And the Anabaptist's destiny was to drown in it. Nothing we can do about it. Nothing we can do to change it. Best to just let it happen. So, if we look at the environment this is taking place in, right, where this novel begins, does Pangloss's philosophy seem to be in any way shaped by his placement, his material conditions at the beginning of this? Essentially, what is Pangloss's social role at the beginning?
Doctor.
Yeah, he's a doctor, so he has a doctorate.
Isn't he like a tutor?
Yeah. He's tutor to whom?
Candide and what's her face?
And Cunegonde and the Baron's son, right?
Yeah.
So essentially, he's tutor to the Baron's children and to Candide, whose relationship to the household is a bit more questionable. So yeah, so he's tutor to the Baron's children. And he's sort of the Baron's pet philosopher, right? Now, what about his life in the barony of Thunder Ten Tronc might lead Pangloss to believe that indeed he does live in the best of all possible worlds?
It's a dreary town.
What's that?
It was a dreary town.
Yeah,
it was,
I mean,
rained all the time.
Yeah, I mean, the
basic question about for him to accept everything as his own will is, you know, can't help it, have it.
Mm-hmm.
You know, for him to have the attitude, how come he became so successful and didn't let that town drag down if he feels that way?
Yeah, well, I think there is something going on here. Right? You're right, right? The Barony of Thunder Ten Tronc, if we look at it here, right? Page 355. There lived in Westphalia, in the castle of the Baron of Thunder Ten Tronc, a young man on whom nature had bestowed the perfection of gentle manners. His features admirably expressed his soul. He combined an honest mind with great simplicity of heart, and I think it was for this reason that they called him Candide. The old servants of the house suspected that he was the son of the Baron's sister by a respectable, honest gentleman of the neighborhood, whom she had refused to marry because he could prove only 71 quarterings. The rest of his family tree, having been lost in the passage of time. So essentially, 71 quarterings means about 71 generations of noble ancestors. Now, we find out a little bit later on that Cunegonde, the Baron's daughter, has 72. So because he only has 71 quarterings, this makes him insufficiently noble, right? Insufficiently aristocratic. So Candide, right, is a bastard with no inheritance because he only has 71 generations of noble ancestors. The Baron was one of the most mighty lords of Westphalia, for his castle had a door and windows. His great hall was even hung with a tapestry. The dogs of his courtyard made up a hunting pack on occasion, with the stable boys as huntsmen. The village priest was his grand almoner. They called him my lord and laughed at his stories. The baroness, who weighed in the neighborhood of 350 pounds, was greatly respected for that reason and did the honors of the house with the dignity which rendered her even more imposing. Her daughter Cunegonde was aged 17, was a ruddy-cheeked girl, fresh, plump, and desirable. The baron's son seemed in every way worthy of his father. The tutor Pangloss is the oracle of the household, and little Candide listened to his lectures with all the good faith of his age and character. So, what kind of description are we given here of Thunder Ten Tronc, of this little barony? What is this place like?
It doesn't seem to be, like, the super most impressive from our eyes.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Because, like, the castle had, like, doors.
And yeah, and the fact that the castle has a door and windows makes it better than all other castles in Westphalia, right? So it doesn't seem to take much in Westphalia to lord it over everybody else, right? He's got a door and windows. He's got a tapestry. He's got a pack of dogs and a pet philosopher. This guy is one of the most, is one of the mightiest lords in the land.
That wife too.
Yeah. Thunder Ten Tronc, right? By our standards, if you look at look, it's a shithole, right? It's a crappy little town. It's got nothing, right? And Voltaire situates his narrative, or begins his narrative anyway, in Westphalia, right? In what is now Germany, for a couple of reasons, right? One, Westphalia was a backwater, right? The whole province was basically bog and swamp. There were no cities of note. It was not especially culturally impressive, right? So it was full of these kinds of little petty lords who ran their little petty towns in much the same way as the baron. But it's also the site of one of the most important historical events of the 17th century. Right, the Peace of Westphalia, signed in 1648, ended two of the first, I guess you wouldn't quite call them world wars, but they were certainly like pan-European wars, right? Have any of you ever heard of the 30 Years' War or the 80 Years' War? Do these ring a bell for either of you? Okay, I heard somebody say, mm-hmm. Okay, so what do you know about either of these conflicts? What do you remember about them? We don't really talk much about them these days, particularly in the US, but remember that Voltaire is writing only about a century after this. So this is, it's maybe not within living memory, but it's within recent cultural memory. 30 Years' War, anybody?
I'm guessing it lasts for 30 years.
Yes, yes, the fighting went on and off for 30 years, yeah. And it was a sort of civil war within the Holy Roman Empire, right? What is now Germany and Austria. And it was over, issues of religious tolerance. At least that was the ostensible reason for it. Essentially, it was about, you know, whether Catholics had the right to practice their religion in Protestant territories, and Protestants had the right to practice their religion in Catholic territories. The 80 Years' War was about the Dutch Republic trying to gain independence from Spain. So what the Peace of Westphalia did, right, first, right, it enshrined religious tolerance as a principle of law. Secondly, it set the borders of most modern European nations. And it established what we call a multipolar balance of power. Does anybody know what that means? When we talk about a balance of power, what are we talking about?
There's always like someone to check, someone to make sure that no one gets too powerful.
Yeah, it's either, right. It's to make sure that no one nation gets too powerful, right? The world power is distributed in such a way to keep that nation in check, right? Now, if we're talking about a multipolar arrangement, then what do we mean? How many poles of power are there?
Multiple.
Multiple, exactly. Lots, right? Now, for most of my childhood, we had what was called a bipolar balance of power, right, between the United States and the Soviet Union. Today, people argue about whether there's a unipolar balance of power with the United States as the world's only superpower, or if we're sort of going back to a kind of multipolar model where power is more evenly distributed around the globe. But these are actually relevant to issues that Voltaire is talking about in this novel for reasons that we'll mostly get into next time. But I just wanted to put this out there and make you guys aware of this, that this is not a place that's arbitrarily chosen, right? There are two reasons. One, it's a swampy backwater. Two, it is also the site of this very important historical event. And because Pangloss lives in the wealthiest and best appointed house in a swampy backwater, what does that mean he gets from the Baron?
The best swampy backwater?
Yeah, he gets the best this swampy backwater has to offer, right? So while he may not be comparable to other more famous German philosophers in other wealthier towns, compared to the people around him, by and large, he's living the high life, right? Within the tiny world of Westphalia, Pangloss is a very important person. Right? He has a roof over his head in the nicest house in the neighborhood, a decent paying job that requires him to do almost nothing but spout bullshit, and a pretty serving maid who services his other needs, right? So, does Pangloss have any reason to believe that he doesn't live in the best of all possible worlds? No, things are pretty good for him. He gets everything he wants. He gets everything he needs. So Pangloss is sort of, he's usually read as Voltaire's parody of what's sometimes called the ivory tower intellectual. Have any of you ever heard this phrase before? When somebody lives in the ivory tower, what does that mean?
They live in the good life.
Okay, on the one hand, yeah, it's a pretty good life. What is the ivory tower a metaphor for?
They're untouchable and removed from the general public.
Yeah, usually what we talk about when we're talking about an ivory tower intellectual, right, is somebody who's never been out of college, right? Somebody who has never left the academy and gone out and done anything else. All right, somebody whose knowledge of the world, whose experience of the world, is primarily theoretical. Right, and it's easy to maintain a theory. Right, it's easy to keep a theory alive if you don't really know anything else, right? if experience has never taught you to question that theory. And that's part of the point of Candide as a novel, right? It's called Candide or Optimism. Now, what do we tend to think of when we think of the word optimism? Yeah, always look on the bright side of life, right? Just, you know, about, you know, just seeing a silver lining in everything, right? Thinking that things are always going to turn out right. Does this novel seem to you to endorse or criticize the idea of optimism?
Criticize.
Yeah, essentially, what Voltaire is saying is in order to be an optimist, you have to ignore everything that's going on around you. Right, to hold on to your optimism as Pangloss does, you have to pretend that everything around you is just great. Everything's going swimmingly. Yay, it's great to be alive. But Candide's actual experiences really sort of belie this, right? What's the first thing that really happens to him? Well, not Candide doesn't get syphilis, right? Pangloss gets syphilis, right? Yeah, first thing that really happens to Candide, Melandria, was what?
He got kicked out.
Yeah, he gets kicked out of Thunderten Tronc, right? Expelled from Westphalia. For what purpose? Yeah, for trying to become Miss Cunegonde's sufficient reason, right? This is all couched in these silly Leibnizian philosophical terms. All right, page 356. One day, while Cunegonde was walking near the castle in the little woods that they call the park, she saw Dr. Pangloss in the underbrush. He was giving a lesson in experimental physics to her mother's maid, a very attractive and obedient brunette. As Miss Cunegonde had a natural bent for the sciences, she watched breathlessly the repeated experiments which were going on. She saw clearly the doctor's sufficient reason, observed both cause and effect, and returned to the house in a distracted and pensive frame of mind, yearning for knowledge and dreaming that she might be the sufficient reason of young Candide, who might also be hers. As she was returning to the castle, she met Candide and blushed. Candide blushed too. She greeted him in a faltering tone of voice, and Candide talked to her without knowing what he was saying. Next day, as everyone was rising from the dinner table, Cunegonde and Candide found themselves behind a screen. Cunegonde dropped her handkerchief. Candide picked it up. She held his hand quite innocently. He kissed her hand quite innocently, with remarkable vivacity and emotion. Their lips met, their eyes lit up, their knees trembled, their hands wandered. The Baron of Thunderten Tronc passed by the screen and, taking note of this cause and this effect, drove Candide out of the castle by kicking him vigorously on the backside. Cunegonde fainted. As soon as she recovered, the Baroness slapped her face, and everything was confusion in the most beautiful and agreeable of all possible castles. So, what has Candide's action done in this perfectly ordered universe?
Disrupted it.
Yeah. Everything's a shambles now, right? And who's the indirect cause?
Pangloss.
Pangloss, exactly, because Cunegonde has observed his experimental physics lessons. So Pangloss's philosophies, which are based on the idea that everything is rationally ordered and organized to a ridiculous extent, have had the ultimate effect of throwing the barony of Thunderten Tronc into chaos and confusion, as his young pupils put his teachings into practice. And so we start the novel with this kind of exile from innocence, right? Right, this innocent place where, okay, yeah, it's a swamp, it's a backwater, but no one really needs anything, right? Everyone has all their needs met. And Candide is expelled from this place into what?
exile.
Exile. And what happens to him in exile?
Abandoned.
Pardon?
What happens to me? Can you repeat that?
Yeah. Once he's in exile, what happens to him next?
He gets forced into the military. Like, two guys find him, and then, like, tells them back, and then kind of, like, says, you're in the military now.
Yep, he gets recruited into the Bulgar army, right? Against his will. Now, this is another reference to real historical events. Does anybody remember anything about Frederick II, who we talked about a little bit, I think not last time, but the time before? Frederick II of Prussia. Okay, what do you remember about Frederick II of Prussia?
He was kind of like more open to different artists.
Yep, he was a patron of artists and philosophers.
He supported Voltaire's work, didn't he?
For a while.
Until he didn't like something.
He and Voltaire were friends and correspondents for some time. In fact, Voltaire went to live at his court for a little while. Didn't work out so well. What was Frederick's philosophy of rule? Anybody remember?
He wanted to rule for the people. He tried to do what was best for the people.
Or at least
enlightenment monarch, was he?
Yeah, an enlightened absolutist, right?
Yeah.
So yeah, he wanted to rule in the way that he thought would be best for the people, but then who's the ultimate arbiter of what's best for the people?
He is.
He is, yeah. So the king of the Bulgars is Voltaire's parody of Frederick II, right? He chooses the name Bulgar because Bulgar was derived from the French word bougre, to bugger. Essentially, Voltaire knew, and it was kind of an open secret generally, that Frederick II was a homosexual. And so he chooses this particular name for Frederick's nation in order to sort of poke a little bit of fun at that.
Wouldn't that be dangerous, though?
Not if he's not living in Prussia. Which he wrote Candide while he was living in exile in Switzerland. And Switzerland has a long history of being more or less completely neutral in all world affairs, which you know, is not a bad policy when you are a small nation that is surrounded by other bigger, more powerful nations that don't get along very well with each other, right? So, so he's poking fun at Frederick in the Bulgar army episodes. But he's also using this as a comment on contemporary wars, right? Frederick was involved at the time in what's called the Seven Years' War. I know that there are a lot of wars in the 17th and 18th century that seem to be named for their lengths. I don't know why. So the Seven Years' War is from about 1556 or 1756 to 1763. It's usually known in the US as the French and Indian War. Though North America was only a very, very small part of the theater of action. Now Frederick was aligned with the English against the French. And at a place called Rossbach, Frederick's force of 20,000 Prussians defeated a force of 60,000 French. Impressive, right? Less so when you think about how they did it. Essentially, Frederick lined his men up on top of a canyon, and the French, as they were coming through, were fired upon by the Prussians, who just routed them. Now, one, Voltaire as a Frenchman felt this sort of pricked his national pride. And two, it seemed to him rather a dirty and underhanded way to win a battle. So he brings in a lot of stuff as a result about the nastiness of warfare. If we look, for example, on page 358, how Candide escaped from the Bulgars and what became of him. Can I get a volunteer to read that paragraph? Nothing could have been so fine. Yes, Ash, go for it.
Nothing could have been so fine, so brisk, so brilliant, so well drilled as the two armies. The trumpets, the fifes, the elbows, the drums, and the cannons produced such a harmony as was never heard in hell. First the cannons battered down about 60,000 men on each side. Then volleys of musket fire removed from the best of words about 9,000 or 10,000 rascals who were cluttered up its surface. The bayonet was a sufficient reason for the demise of several thousand others. Total casualties might well amount to 30,000 men or so. Candide, who was trembling like a philosopher, hid himself as best he could while the heroic butchery was going on. Finally...
Oh, that's good. You can stop there. So what do you notice about the language of this paragraph?
It was kind of like really sarcastic, the way he said, like, oh, you're so great, you were able to do this.
Yeah, it's laced with irony, right? Heroic butchery. What other kind of terms do we see this laced with? Do we recognize any of these other?
I'd be saying like the trumpets and drums and cannons produced a harmony.
Yeah.
But he also said it was hellish, so.
Yeah, such a harmony as was never heard in hell, right? So yeah, you're on to what's going on here, right? He is also here mocking the Leibniz ideas, right? The pre-established harmony. So apparently, pre-established harmony demands that all of these monads destroy each other with cannons and guns. This is what they're programmed to do. What else do we see? Where else do we see this kind of language in this paragraph? Other familiar terms we see here.
Sufficient reason.
Sufficient reason, yep. Yep, and the best of all worlds. So in this Leibnizian deterministic universe, right, where everything is ordered for the best, 30,000 people slaughter each other for no good reason. Right, so this really is Candide's first experience with how vicious and nasty the world outside of Westphalia really is, right? And if we look a little further down in this episode, it points to another kind of important thematic idea that runs through the novel, right? Finally, while the two kings in their respective camps celebrated the victory by having Te Deum sung, Candide undertook to do his reasoning of cause and effect somewhere else. Passing by mounds of the dead and dying, he came to a nearby village which had been burnt to the ground. It was an Abare village, which the Bulgars had burned, in strict accordance with the laws of war. Here, old men, stunned from beatings, watched the last agonies of their butchered wives, who still clutched their infants to their bleeding breasts. There, disemboweled girls, who had first satisfied the natural needs of various heroes, breathed their last. Others, half scorched in the flames, begged for their death stroke. Scattered brains and severed limbs littered the ground. Now, we talk about scattered brains and severed limbs. Is this the only place in this half of the novel where we see this kind of like language of dismemberment?
No.
Where else do we see something like this?
Whenever he's talking about, whenever Angus comes to talking about the barons.
Okay, yeah. This is what happened to the barons. To the barons' village, right? What about the old lady? Why can she only ride a horse upon one buttock?
Because because it happened to her too whenever she was going through her like enslavement in the war.
Yeah, she only has one, right? The other was eaten as a steak by the people she was locked up with at one point, right? And what about what happened to the old woman's mother and all of her attendants? How did they die?
They were cut up in that war, in the same war that she was in, whenever they arrived in Africa.
Yep, torn to pieces, cut to bits by pirates, right? So what we see here is a conception of the human body as a collection of things, right? Disparate parts, disparate objects that can be pulled apart. Now, how might this reference specific philosophical ideas that we looked at earlier in this period? Yeah.
You're the parts, you know, you can take the body apart so easily, but you can still go on with your mind.
Exactly right. Yes, exactly. If the mind is the only part of you that's really you, if the immaterial mind is all that matters, right, everything else is just flesh, right? Everything else is just stuff. You're just a thing. And if you are treating people as just sort of jumbled collections of things, it's fairly easy to be cruel to them. Right? If you don't feel like you're dealing with another mind, with another self, right? If you're just looking at it in terms of a body and the parts of the body. Now, this also has something to do with, right? You'll find that characters continually die and come back throughout the narrative. So that's one thing that I do want you to sort of keep thinking about here. Keep this in mind as you read the rest of it. I also have, so we're going to end a little bit early today. I have some reading questions for you for next time. Don't forget to turn in your in-class writings as you go. And we'll finish this up on Thursday.